out on the front desk. Please take a confession card home. You can use it for anything. There are a whole bunch of topics on there, but it's good stuff. Say, this is my Bible. I am what God says I am. I have what God says I have. I can do what God says I can do. Today I will receive the incorruptible, ever living, never changing, Holy Ghost powered Word of God, and I'll be changed. In Jesus' name. Amen. Why? I want the house to shake. All right, so we've been talking about the kingdom. And today I want to tell you exactly why it's important to understand the kingdom and how the kingdom operates, especially in the days in which we live. It is extremely important. Matthew chapter 4, verse 17, real quick. After Jesus gets baptized in the Holy Spirit, he comes out, he goes into the wilderness, and the very first message that he preaches is this. He says, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is here. Real simple. Matthew 4:17. He says, from that time Jesus began to preach and to say, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand, or is here, or is near. He's saying basically, here I am, folks. I am the king. Now you need to repent. And the Greek word for repent is you know, we think it's asking for forgiveness, it's getting on your knees and crying and all that. The Greek word literally, it includes that, but the Greek word literally means to change your thinking. That's what it literally means, to think differently. So he's saying this, from this point on, you need to start thinking differently. Right? Because up to that point, you know, they did their way, you know, their way, my way or the high. But Jesus comes in and says, now you need to start thinking differently. And he began to introduce to them the kingdom of heaven, or the kingdom of God. Because he said, from this time, that's all he began to teach. He began to teach them how it operated, how we live in it, how we coexist in two kingdoms. Because in Colossians 1:13, it says, after you're born again, it says you are translated from the kingdom of Satan, from the kingdom of darkness, into the kingdom of his son. Right? So there are two kingdoms that exist right now on this earth. Is the kingdom of Satan. He is the god of this age, or the god of this world. It says the prince of the power of the air. And then we have Jesus, who has his own kingdom, but it's a spiritual kingdom. Now, I want to do an example, and I know this may be like really, people may think it's wrong, but I have a reason for it, and it's the best way I can explain how two kingdoms can exist at the same time. All right? So it has nothing to do with politics at all, okay? Is there anybody in here who is a green card holder? Can you come up here for a minute? Thank you. Sorry, you put you right on the spot. Look at this handsome man. Are you single? Ken?
Ken, yeah.
Are you single?
Kirsten's father.
Yes, I know. Are you single?
More or less.
So just for the single ladies out there.
It's complicated.
It's complicated, so not yet, ladies. Don't touch them. And we don't want complicated. All right, so you're a green card holder.
Yes.
Okay, so I am an American citizen. He is a green card holder, but he is allowed to live here in the United States, right? The difference is you can't vote, correct?
Correct.
I can vote. So notice we live in the same area, but have rights and privileges of two different kingdoms. How is that? He can get the same fat steak as I eat, right? You like steak? Okay. So he can buy a house.
Yes.
You can buy a house. There's lots of things that he can do and I can do because we're both living in the same country. But the kingdom he lives in limits his rights because he's not completely in my kingdom. Okay, you understand? I can vote, he can't. Here's the other thing. I'm born here. That means that I can become president. He can become a citizen, naturalized citizen, but you can never become president.
That's my understanding.
Yes. For now. So do you understand here are two different kingdoms living in the same place, but have two different rights and privileges? We can both live and breathe the air, right? Exist, make money, work. But when you get deep into it, I have privileges that he doesn't. I'm not, again, this is nothing about politics, but this is the best way I can show you two kingdoms living together with different rights and privileges. Does that make sense to everybody? Good? Okay, that's it. Thank you. God bless you. Hopefully you'll be a citizen one day and you can have rights and privileges.
That's my plan.
That's your plan? Good. All right. Be a citizen. Good, good. Amen. And don't be complicated. There are a lot of women, single women in the church. Yikes! Praise Jesus. So everybody see that? So, watch this. So, I am, when I got born again, I'm in God's kingdom. I have rights and privileges that I can still exist, you know, I'm still living in Satan's world, but my rights and privileges come from him. Amen. I can also exercise these, but I have more because I'm born again. I have a right to call on God. I have a right for Holy Spirit to intervene in my life. I have a right to go to heaven. I have a right to the riches and glory in Christ Jesus, my Lord. I have a right to healing. So I have all these rights that I can call upon because I'm in God's kingdom. When you're not born again, you can't call on God for anything but salvation. That's a guarantee. That's it. Everything that I can call upon as being born again is a guarantee. He will supply all my needs according to his kingdom. He will heal my body according to his kingdom. He'll heal he'll touch my life. He'll give me peace of mind according to his kingdom. Peace that surpasses all understanding, because over here, I don't understand. And I'm anxious, and I got no peace, and I just don't understand how God's going to come through or how I'm going to make it through. But here, I don't have to understand how to make it through. I just know God will do it. You understand the difference in the kingdoms. You need to learn that when things get tough over here, because you still got to live here, you need to step over here and get into those rights and privileges. Amen? Let me give you another example. So 3 years ago, I went to Egypt to teach the Bible, and it was all undercover. I couldn't bring my Bible. You know, for a week, I had to teach from up here. So when I landed in Egypt, the whole country lives under Sharia law. Okay? So here I am, an American, not understanding Sharia law much. You know, I did a little research just to understand the custom, the culture. But now I land in Cairo, get off the plane, get my bag, and now I'm walking over to the baggage claim. And I look at the baggage claim, what number it is, and it says wait time 15 minutes. Awesome. Long, beautiful airport, long. Got to the place, all of a sudden, my baggage claim thing said 20 minutes, then it went 30 minutes, then it went 46 minutes. And I'm like, what in the world? And then all of a sudden I hear the prayer call, and all the workers drop on the floor, take their mats out, and face mech and start praying. So because that's Sharia law, everything shuts down. I could not exercise my right to complain, as all Americans do, and protest in a land I had no rights and privileges in. Do you understand? So I had to respect that. So the kingdom of the United States cannot operate privileges in the kingdom of Egypt. You understand? So you need to understand that. Okay, how that operates. And so I had to respect it. 46, you know, so I took a seat. You know, just prayed for myself. Got every 46 minutes, everything opened up and walked out. So we have these kingdoms on the earth, but we need to know when we can exercise our rights and privileges. Good? Okay. Let me take Luke 17. So how do you access this? It's real simple. How do we access this? Well, Luke 17, verse 20. First of all, you need to know what your rights and privileges are. You got to study the Word. You got to read your Bible. You got to know it. There's no shortcut, you know, Bible for dummies. You know, you got to get in and study the Bible. Amen. There's no shortcut. You know, we love, you know, Americans, we're big on fast food, fast this, fast that, you know, easy pass, you know, everything is quick. No, you need to learn the Word. You need to spend time studying, knowing God. Now, Luke 17, he says this in verse 20. Jesus said, he says, now when he was asked by the Pharisees when the kingdom of God would come, he answered them and said, the kingdom of God does not come with observation. In other words, you can't, now don't sit there, look around, you know, tapping your toes waiting for it to come. He says this, nor will they say here or see there, for indeed the kingdom of God is within you. He says this is a spiritual place that can only take place when you're born again and God will come in you. Greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. When Jesus comes to live, he comes to live in you, not with you, in you. Now, he is with you, but you know what I mean. This is a preposition. This is a time and place and space where he comes not to stand by your side. He actually lives in you. I know the Holy Spirit is your paraclete, your standby. I get it. But he's in you. Amen. Ephesians, can you put Ephesians 3:20 up on the screen? Watch what this scripture says. It says, but to him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we can ever ask or think, according to the power that works in you. You got it? There it is. Now, Tim is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that works in us. Very good. Now go to Romans 8:11. If the same Spirit that raised Christ from the dead lives in you, he gives life, he quickens your mortal body. You got it? Romans 8:11. All you got to do is click, click. There you go. Or is it a three-clicker? Three? Okay. So, but if the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, notice where he is. Jesus was very clear. He says the kingdom is in, in you. He who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his Spirit who dwells in you. I mean, you can't pass this up. He's in you, he's in you, he's in you. The kingdom lives within you. Now, I'm not going to teach faith because I've done it for years, but how do you get that? How do you access that? By speaking in faith, by declaring it out. How does a government make law? By decreeing it. They establish law that way. And we are called to speak and decree a thing, the Bible says, and it shall be established. But to him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly, according to all that we can ever ask or think, right? So he does above and beyond according to what's in us. So how do we access this kingdom? By declaring it. And believing it and not backing down from it. Amen. Now, let me say this. I'm going to veer off a little bit because I just felt led to do it this way. All right. I studied a lot. I got a lot of info, but I was trying to follow the leading of the Spirit on what to share today. And this is the direction that I went with. Let me tell you a little bit about Satan. Don't be as scared. You mentioned Satan. Don't talk about him. I'm afraid he's coming for me. You need to know this one thing, that he is out to steal, kill, and destroy you and everybody around you. You need to know that. He is an outlaw. He is a criminal. He is a lawbreaker. He doesn't care about your rights and privileges. You'll understand how this translates into the kingdom in a few minutes. He doesn't care of your rights, privileges in God's kingdom. He doesn't care that you're a Christian.
Hi.
Thank you. I'm going to move it over here because on the camera, it's in a really bad spot. Yeah. Thank you. Appreciate it. He has no regard for God. He has no regard for you. And here's the funny thing about him. He knows the difference between right and wrong, and he doesn't care. Understand his nature, and you'll understand why I'm saying this. He's a criminal. He's an outlaw. He's a lawbreaker. He doesn't care the rights and privilege. He couldn't care less that you're a Christian. He couldn't care less that you belong to God. He hates you just as much as anybody else. Right. Now, here is where it gets interesting. He knows there's things he cannot do to you, but he does it anyway. Yeah. Why? Because he doesn't listen. He is totally rebellious and disobedient. Well, I'm telling Devin he has no right to do that. Guess what? He's going to try. Even though he has no right, he's going to do it anyway. Why? Because he doesn't listen. He had no right to put COVID on me. But he did. And God had every right to heal me. Do you understand the difference? The Bible says, no weapon formed against you shall prosper. They'll forming, they won't prosper. We stand our ground. Well, gee, Pastor, you may not have faith because the devil put. No, he knew he can't do it, but he tried. Because I understand his nature. He's a criminal. There's not one criminal out there that follows the law. Come on, do you think Satan is the master criminal? He made them. It's their nature. So he's not going to listen to you. That's when you say, yep, in Jesus' name, by his stripes, I was healed. Amen. Devil, you can try. I know you're going to try. I know you're going to think you prosper, but God works all things out for my good, for those who love and called according to his purpose. Devil, sorry, I know who you are. I understand your game plan. You don't listen. You're rebellious, ugly, stupid, idiot, law-breaking, you know, whatever, Cabados, whatever you Italians call it. But I will, who? Gabagol? But I know this, that my God has every right to heal me. Amen. I know my rights and privileges. Amen. And I will fully recover, and this foul thing shall not come on me a second time. Amen. So do you understand that who he is now, his nature? He doesn't care. Because of that, God needs law enforcers. Because he is the lawbreaker, God needs law enforcers on the earth. Amen. And that's the church. That is you and me. Listen, Jesus said this, that wherever, he says, here's my command, go and preach the gospel, right, to every creature. Be a witness to all nations. And he said, if you find sick people who the devil, that lousy lawbreaker, has put sickness on, you lay hands on them and they shall recover. Amen. You go cast out devils because he's going to infiltrate. He may mess with people in your family. He says, you declare and tell the devil to get out. Do you understand you're the law enforcers of God's word in his kingdom? Because some people don't understand why the devil does things. Like, I can't believe the devil came for me. I can't believe he did it. Dude, he doesn't listen. That's what he does. That's his specialty. But guess what God's specialty is? He'll roll up his sleeves in the middle of chaos. And he said, light be. Healed in Jesus' name. Saved. Lazarus, get up out of that grave. Hallelujah. When things look dead, you just stand your ground and say, Jesus is the Lord of lords. He is a King of kings, Almighty God, the resurrection and the life. I command you, Lazarus, to come forth.
Yes.
Amen. Sharon, can you put up the first slide? I want you to go to Matthew 6. It's a slide that I used, I think it was about, I don't know, 6, 7, 8, 9 weeks ago, 10, 11 weeks ago, something like that. I want you to go to Matthew 16 while that slide is up. Matthew 16 and verse 18. And I want to talk about the keys. I want to spend time talking about the keys to the kingdom. Matthew 16, verse 18. It says, and I also say to you that you are Peter. Actually, you can put the scripture up. I'm sorry, Sharon. He says, and I also say to you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church. Underline that in your Bible. If you can't underline in your Bible, throw it out and get one that you can. I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And I will give you the keys of the kingdom. Underline, I'm going to spend time now talking about the keys of the kingdom. And whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Everybody got that? So notice Jesus is, and I taught on this, you know, about 2 months ago, that Jesus is introducing something called the church. The first time it's ever mentioned in Scripture. It's not mentioned in the Old Testament at all. First time he says it, and they're all like, church, church, what's your church? Church? You're going to, church? And they knew, listen, the church, as I taught, is something, is a Greek form of government that was founded in Athens in 594 B.C., and the Greek form of government was a group of people that were Athenian citizens that were allowed to make law, permit or prohibit whatever they wanted. That was their role. And he says this now. He says, I am going to introduce my government on the earth. And I'm calling it the church. The church is it's all about government on the earth. And notice he equates it with this. I'll build my church. The gates of hell will not prevail. So notice he says this, that the church is coming against the gates of hell. I'm putting the church on the earth to stand against the gates of hell. The gates are our doors to his kingdom, Satan's kingdom. The church is the door to God's kingdom. He says, I'm putting something against that because I've had enough. Now put you can put the thing up. So this kingdom, this slide. Thank you. Okay. So I know this slide may be a little difficult, but Daniel talks about 70 weeks, and I taught this, but I want to be really clear here. In the middle, where the church age begins, can you see that? Does everybody see that, or is it too light? Okay, do the other one. I brought up the backup plan. All right, this is one that's on the internet. It's darker, so you could see it. But I like mine better. But that's me. All right. So Daniel's 70 weeks. We've studied it. Right, 69 have passed. Then the pause button was put on, and then something in the middle. Paul talks about something in the middle that is a mystery. The dispensation of the Gentiles. Jesus said that the end won't come until the spoken by the prophet Daniel, the abomination desolation, which Paul talks about, which John talks about in the book of Revelation, being the Antichrist. We know him as the Antichrist. So it was a future thing coming. And in the middle of that, we have what we call the 2,000-year gap, the church age. So when God put the stop button on Israel after 69 weeks, he introduces the church, and he says, you, church, are my kingdom. Kingdom is only mentioned, when he talks about kingdom of heaven, it's only mentioned in the New Testament. So he introduces this kingdom, his kingdom, and he says, and you guys have a responsibility. Your responsibility is to permit or prohibit things. I'm giving you keys that come responsibility as well, but your job is to preach the gospel and be a witness until the very end. After you're done, then the end comes. Amen. Got it? Amen. He says, so you got to get this job done, and then the end comes. He's very clear, crystal clear. So we know when we're doing our job, Jesus said, right, we know throughout there's going to be a rapture. That at the end of the church age, when we're done doing our job, Jesus, he's going to rapture us out of here. So our job is to stand against his kingdom, Satan's kingdom. So God introduces his kingdom. You're standing against his kingdom. When the job is done, he's going to take us out of here. He's going to rapture us. And we're going to escape the worst tribulation that you've ever seen, the worst evil that we've ever seen on the planet. We're going to escape that. Jesus said it. Jesus said, pray that you be counted worthy. Amen. You think evil is rampant on the earth now? Well, we're here and we're holding it at bay. But when we're gone, Satan's kingdom overruns the earth. He's world power. And there will be evil like you've never seen before. Then for 7 years, right, it's on the earth, people, billions of people die. The fish die, all the fish in the sea, air, oxygen becomes almost gone, trees are gone, you know, the planet is bombed with nuclear bombs, with asteroids hit it, and then Satan is loosed, and just a whole bunch of stuff. And then we get to come back with Jesus and take over the earth and establish his kingdom for 1,000 years. But he said, until that time comes, I need you to stay on the earth. I need you to exercise my kingdom. Get busy, stay busy. Don't be moved by what you see or what you hear. You occupy, you work until I come back. I'll come and get you. I promise I'm coming to get you. And I'll get you out here to escape the wrath that's about to come. So you think this is bad? This is nothing. You should rejoice the fact that you got up this morning. I praise you, Lord God, because your kingdom is on this earth right now. It lives in me, and greater is he that is in me than he that's in the world. And the wrath of the devil cannot overtake this earth while I'm here. But I know there's a day coming. Woe to those that are left behind. I'm going to say, woe, woe, woe. She's a lady. No. Woe. The Bible is full of woes. Yo. So, you can get rid of that. Matthew 16 again. So let me talk about the keys. So what do these keys represent? There are several keys mentioned in the Bible. Okay? One is the key of the house of David. Another one is called the key of knowledge. There are the keys of death and hell that Jesus has. There is the key to the bottomless pit. So those are kind of the four keys that are mentioned throughout the Bible. You can look it up. The key of the house of David, or Revelation 3 calls it the key of David. It's found in Samuel 5 and Revelation 7. The key of knowledge is found in Luke 11. I'm going to go through and show you these. The keys of death and hell that Jesus has. When he conquered Satan and hell, he took the keys of death and hell. And then there's the key to the bottomless pit that they lock Satan up. Okay, and Jesus has that too. Praise the Lord. So there are these keys. So let me explain what a key. A key is an instrument for opening a door or starting a car, right? That's, we know it now. Nowadays, you don't even need keys, right? You just press buttons or you swipe your phone, right? It's amazing how things have, but it's still a key. Right? In those days, it was a key that opened a door. Now, when you were in possession of a key, so how many of you have bought homes, right? And at the when you signed the papers, right, what happens? Right, you sign the lawyers, you transfer your half your life away, you know, $500,000 or whatever it is to buy a house these days, right? You're sweating. What do? They say, here's the keys. So you get two keys for $500,000. You get two keys. What a blessing. This week, my son needed my car because he went to New Hampshire, so he needed my, it's an SUV. So he says, Dad, you can use my M3 for the weekend. So he gave me the keys to his BMW M3. I'm like, yeah. So here's the deal. When you have the keys, you now possess what this key has access to. And now I've become a steward over my son's car for the weekend. He says, I trust you with your key, with your car. Here's my keys. You can run it, drive it, use the gas, spin those wheels, drift, race down 95, do whatever you want. I trust you as a steward of the keys that I give you. So check this out. So what Jesus did is, here, I'm giving you the keys to my kingdom. He says, now you can come in. You can have access to anything inside of it. You can use it as you please. You can do what you want. You can stay as long as you want. You can take with you what you want. You can bring whatever you want. I trust you. Amen. I've given you the keys to my kingdom. Come on in and dine. Enjoy all, because it's all yours. Whew. So let me explain the keys real quick, all right? Because I know it's getting late. The key of David. The key of David is found in 2 Samuel chapter 5, verse 6, and it's also found in Revelation 3, 7. Let me explain real quick what the key meant when it talks about the key of David. The whole story of 2 Samuel chapter 5, verse 6, here it's really cool. So David now, King David, he knows he needs to conquer Jerusalem. And it's a fortified city, and the only way in is through a gate. But there's no way in. I believe it's the Jebusites who ran it at the time, and they say, there is no way you're coming in here. You're not taking it. But David knew in his heart, this is why he was a man after God's own heart, because he knew Jerusalem belongs to God. And that's going to be where Jesus is going to sit as king. Amen. So I need to get Jerusalem. He knew that in his heart. As bad as David was, adulterer, murderer, punk kid, you know, he talked up a storm with Goliath. He was haughty, gloating. Who's this Samson guy, Goliath guy, fee-fi-fo-fum, I'm going to kill you. But you know what? God knew his heart. Because he knew one day, David's going to take my kingdom. He's going to conquer Jerusalem. And it'll be, and because of that, I will call it the city of David. Now, in order to get in, there's no way in, but David said there is one way in. There's a water shaft that goes underneath the city. But you got to be really small, or you got to be really cunning. You got to sneak and slip in through there, and you may not make it in. But once you get inside the gates, he says you can go then to where they hide the key, grab the key, and unlock the gate and open the doors to the city. So he did a concept. He said, whatever man can go in through the water shaft and grab the key, I will make you chief. And so there was one man who did. Jehu, was it? I don't remember. What does it say up there? No. Ding, 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 ding. Wait. Hello? I'm in church. Yes, can you call me back? So watch what happens. So he enters the gate, he unlocks the gate from the inside. Yeah. He gets in from the inside. David storms, takes the city, and God says, those are the keys of David that opens up the city of Jerusalem. It's a special key because it comes from the inside. You had to sneak around to come in from the inside. Now, go to Revelation. It's Joab. Sorry, I wrote it down. He opened the door from the inside and established. Now, listen. Let me say this real clear. That city was considered a stronghold. I forgot to mention this. This is the key point here. That city was a stronghold. Everybody know what a stronghold is? In other words, nobody could tear it down. But the way to get in was from the inside, and he tore down the stronghold. In 2 Corinthians 10:4, it says that the word of God, the weapons of our warfare, are not carnal, but the pulling down of strongholds. In other words, one of those keys that Jesus gave us from the kingdom, it has the power and authority to take down strongholds. So the church, listen, here's my point. If your kid has been taken by the drug, the gates of hell that's called drugs, you can walk up to it and declare, I have the key of David and I am. You let go of my kid, you stronghold. I command you now in Jesus' name because I have the key of the kingdom. I have the authority to tear down strongholds. There are some things you don't pray about. There's some things you just say it. He says, you can go, right? The weapons of our warfare, not, we talked about weapons, you know, about spiritual warfare that we're in. There's a lot of Christians that just don't know how to fight spiritually anymore. We need to get up and fight. I said this a couple weeks ago. We're in a fight. This is not complacent Christianity. Popular Christianity is unbiblical. Biblical Christianity is unpopular. A motivational pastor, speaker, preacher makes nothing but happy sinners. I'm not putting anybody down. Hey! Because Revelation 3:7, go there now. Notice this key, Revelation 3:7, and I'm going to go to the next key. Sorry, I know it's a little long. Is it all right? You guys good? Yeah. If you need to leave, that's okay. I love you anyway. Revelation 3:7, he talks about the key of David when it comes to the Church of Philadelphia. The Church of Philadelphia was the church of love. Verse 7, and to the angel of the church of Philadelphia write, these things says he who is holy and who is true and who has the key of David. I want you to notice in every single church, he gives certain characteristics. In this one, he is specific, holiness and truth. And it's associated with the key of David. Because let me tell you something. When the devil lies to you and gets you trapped and deceived, it's truth that'll tear down that stronghold. Amen. It's truth that'll set you free. Amen. It's truth. The Bible says that the truth shall set us free. Yes. That you're not condemned. You're not living in shame. God forgave you. I mean, there's so much to this. I don't have enough time. He says, and he has the key of David. He who opens, watch this, and no one shuts, and shuts, and no one opens. Truth opens doors. God, the key of David will open doors for you that no one else can open up. And God will shut doors that no one can shut. He'll keep the devil at bay. But we need to learn that we're up against the gates of hell. The church is here to fight to stand against the gates of hell. Okay. Use your keys, baby. You got the key. All right, let me do the next one real quick, and then the others you have. The key of knowledge, Luke 11. Luke 11, the key of knowledge. And then I'll be done. Thank you for your patience. Thank you for your support. This sermon is brought to you by... and I approve this message. Amen. Yes. Imagine if Jesus just stand up and said, I approve that message. Luke 11. All right, where are we? Luke 11, verse 45. Let's start there. I like this one. Luke 11, 45. He says, then one of the lawyers answered and said to him, teacher, by saying these things, you tick me off. He says, you reproach us also. That's what it literally means. He says, I'm ticked off. I'm a lawyer and you tick me off. Now, I want you to understand, lawyers, sorry, Janice, lawyers, watch this. And he said, woe to you lawyers, for you load men with burdens that are hard to bear, and you yourselves do not touch the burdens with one of your fingers. Woe to you, for you build tombs of the prophets, and your fathers killed them. In fact, you bear witness that you approve the deeds of your fathers, for they indeed killed them, and you build their tombs. Therefore, the wisdom of God also said, I will send them prophets, apostles, and them and kill them, and persecute. Verse 52, he says, woe to you lawyers, for you have taken away the key of knowledge. You did not enter in yourselves, and those who were entering in you hindered. Let me explain to you exactly what he's doing. Now, I'm not chopping on lawyers at all. But a lawyer will take a case and defend their guy no matter what, right? That's their job, just to defend somebody. I didn't say they lied, but they lie. No. So I'm sorry if you're a lawyer. I'm not chopping on lawyers. I know Janice works with lawyers, and I apologize in advance if you're watching. Just get saved, and we'll be okay. So he says this, you lawyers, you bend the truth. He says, there's a key of knowledge that you've ruined. And he's talking to Jews, specifically to the Jews. And he says, because you've bended the truth, you've perverted the truth, there are people can no longer understand the word of God. You've perverted the word of God and the key of knowledge. Jesus gave the key of knowledge to the church so we can preach truth. Amen. Not my opinion. Not something that comes from the world, but to teach the word. Yes. To preach the kingdom. Yes. That's the key of knowledge. And when I give you the key of knowledge, then you can understand truth. Amen. Not something I've come up with. Finally, Matthew 16, and I'm done. Matthew 16, 19, watch this. These are keys that you have as a kingdom. You have truth. You have the key of knowledge. So you can understand the word. You can preach the truth. Matthew 16, verse 19, we'll be done. Watch this. He says, and I will give you the keys of the kingdom, and watch what they do. These keys are specific that they are the kingdom, and whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth will be loose in heaven. So these keys have everything to do with binding and loosing. And I said this in the Greek literally means permitting or prohibiting. So he says that these keys that you have either will permit things to happen or prohibit things from happening. Now, this comes from Psalm 105 and back in Genesis 45, I believe, and it relates to Joseph, this term, binding and loosing. Joseph, remember Joseph? Right? He became governor over all of Pharaoh's stuff, right? And Pharaoh said this to Pharaoh was the king, right? Pharaoh said this, Joseph, I give you the power to bind and loose any prince and anything in my government. And in Psalm 105, it says this, that Joseph bound princes. In other words, Ephesians 6:12, remember we said, right, that we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but principalities and powers and princes, right? He's a prince of the power of the air. So Joseph had the power to take a prince of Egypt over it and bite a neck and pull him aside, you're out. I bind you. He had the power to loose things in the kingdom of Pharaoh because Pharaoh gave him the power. The king gave him the power. And guess who? The King of Kings gave us the same power to grab the prince of the power of the air by the neck. That prince that of addiction by the neck. That prince of anxiety by the neck. That prince of sickness. The prince of poverty and lack. That prince of divorce by the neck. And say, I sit over there. And don't you move till I let you. I bind you right now. In Jesus' name. Woo, baby. That all comes from God's kingdom. Hallelujah. I don't know why I'm fired up about this, but I've been saying this for weeks. We need to fight. You just got to get a fight in you. And don't allow things in your life, in your companies, in your homes, in your bodies. Just fight it. I said this in one of my emails. I respect COVID, but I ain't afraid of it. Why? Because I got one who's greater. And he's given me keys that I can access at any time to bring healing into my body. And I said this 8 months ago. I'll say it again. Anybody watching, if you have COVID, come see me. I'll lay hands on you, and we believe God, you'll be healed. I ain't afraid of it. But I respect its power, but we ain't afraid of it. Ain't afraid of the gates of hell at all. Why? Because Jesus stands with us, and he's given us the keys. Amen? Stand to your feet. Say! If I could dance, I would dance. Can you do it? I can't do it. Sorry. I don't have rhythm. What you got? Anything? Nothing? This is how we fight our battles.
This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I
praise the Lord. God's equipped you to fight every battle and win every battle. Amen?
Amen.
Father, thank you for these people, wonderful, wonderful people, even online. I pray a blessing over their lives. In Jesus' name.